Good evening, everyone. Mike Barrick here at the Springfield Civic Center, where once again we present Springfield Indians hockey on Continental Cablevision, our final regular season broadcast of 1984-85. As usual, our guest on our Coach's Corner show, the coach of the Springfield Indians, Lorne Henning. And first of all, Coach, this is the final game of the season and coming to a close before the playoffs come about, starting on Wednesday night. How would you assess the season as it's gone for the year for the Springfield Indians?
Well, I guess we've had a lot of ups and downs. The first part of the year, we were in a downer, and now the last part of the year, we're in a bit of a downer. And the middle part, December, we played very well. We were probably the strongest team in the league in December. And so we've, I guess with the call-ups and everything, it's been frustrating and at times. And, you know, basically been a lot of movements with the younger guys and coming in and out. And but overall, I guess a lot of guys improved. A lot of guys have played in the NHL and got some experience, and so it's been a rewarding year that way.
How have you enjoyed your year in Springfield personally?
Well, I've enjoyed Springfield. You know, it's a great area. I love the surroundings and off the ice and on the ice. It's you know, it's been frustrating at times, as I said. But overall, you know, I think the guys have enjoyed it. And you know, that fans could be at times a little more patient, I think. You know, but as far as they're concerned, I guess with the turnovers every year, it's tough to get identity, but, you know, it's been tough on the players sometimes. We play in a great game or come home with the travel, whatever the situation, and, you know, and the fans aren't as patient as I think they should be. You know, they get on us a little too early, and especially the younger guys, and they don't really give them a chance. And, but I can see their point a few times. You know, they if we don't play a great game, what they expect, you know, they have to play to a certain level, but a lot of times there's a lot of different things go into it.
Coach, I know there have been some good times and bad times. Looking back, has there been anything really that you can look back on and say, boy, this was something that I'll really look back and enjoy?
Well, I guess the whole year basically has been something that I'm always going to remember. The first part of the year, you know, I didn't think we'd ever win 15 games and, you know, to turn it around and play as great as we were playing. And then just to go through the streak we were going through again, but just the players that went up and have played well, that, you know, the Corkos and the Graham and Balachek, Rose, Gordy Dineen, there's been seven or eight guys that went up there and have played outstanding, and it's, you know, that's got to be rewarding for the guys that have been here and been a part of it. And, you know, Timmy Kulis went up and he played great, and you know, he got hurt, unfortunately, and he's hurt now. He got tried to come back and he's hurt again, but just, you know, we've had some major people taken out of our lineup, and it's a credit to the guys that are still here. They come up and they picked up the slack, and even a guy like Terry Tate, who only scored one goal last year, and now he's got 19, so Bobby Bodak, how he's come along, guys that, you know, you didn't expect a lot from, but it played outstanding.
Coach, what have you learned most this year?
Well, I guess, you know, it's with younger players, I guess the toughest part is for younger players, concentration, preparation, things. And a lot of things, you know, the thing that I've been trying to stress all year is self-motivation a lot of times. And the players, you know, one night can look great, the next night can look like they don't belong on the ice. And, you know, they have to prepare themselves mentally and physically. And they are young, a lot of times, you know, they take things for granted, think they should be ready when they're not. And it's, you know, you have to sort of guide them along sometimes. And that's the thing that you got to, when they get up there, when they're ready to go, they have to be doing it on their own. And that's why we're here. We have to, it's a learning experience for everybody. And, you know, that's one thing they have to do. They have to motivate themselves.
Coach, one final question. Let's assess this Binghamton Whalers series, the Indians and the Whalers in round one. What's your assessment of the upcoming playoffs?
Well, Binghamton is obviously the toughest team in the league, and you know they've lost a couple of key people, but they're still strong, and you know they've got some people there we have to shut down, and if we can do that, I think we'll do all right. We have to pick our game up from what it is right now. Obviously, we've wrapped it up last weekend, so we've got a bit of a letdown, and we're not playing with the intensity that we should be, or, you know, it's tough to get them up when we know the games really don't mean anything. But God, as I said earlier, young guys, and they don't really realize that you can't really turn it on and step on the ice Wednesday night. You have to sort of lead into it, and it's one of the things, we got two games to sort of prepare. But hopefully we can, you know, if we get good goaltending and, you know, we play our positions and don't panic, don't get run around and keep our composure, we'll be all right.
Well, Coach, good luck against the Binghamton Whalers in round one, and congratulations on your first year with the Springfield Indians, a playoff-bound team, and I'm sure for you an interesting one, to say the least.
Well, thanks, Mike. Thank you for having the a great year and helping us out.
And thank you for carrying me like you have all season long.
Oh, you're welcome, Mark.
Lauren Henning, coach of the Springfield Indians, Indians hockey, coming up against the New Haven Nighthawks. We'll be back with Springfield Indians hockey in just a moment.
Exerskate just for the health of it at the Springfield Olympia Ice and Roller Sports Center, your year-round sports facility. You can enjoy ice and roller skating as well as indoor soccer and floor hockey. The Springfield Olympia Ice and Roller Center has a full skate and pro shop, so you'll find what you're looking for. From amateurs to experts and anyone in between, a complete snack bar will satisfy that athletic appetite. For birthday parties, club get-togethers, or special occasions, renting a rink is the fun way to throw a party. And it's as easy as the Springfield Olympia Sports Center, conveniently located at exit 13 off I-91.
Continental Cablevision presents the Springfield Indians against the New Haven Nighthawks. Good evening, everyone. Mike Barak along with John Forslund, and welcome to the Springfield Civic Center, where tonight the Springfield Indians conclude the regular schedule at home against the New Haven Nighthawks. John Forslund, this is our final regular season broadcast on Continental Cablevision, and tonight the Indians will conclude against their bitter rivals, the New Haven Nighthawks.
Well, Mike, the season's flown right by, and we've had a great schedule here on Continental Cable. Looking forward to tonight's action and really looking forward to those upcoming Calder Cup playoffs. The Indians trying to get themselves on a positive note before the start of the playoffs.
That's right. The Indians and the Binghamton Whalers will meet up in round one of the American Hockey League Southern Division semifinals this week. But of course, before we get to that, the Indians will conclude their regular schedule, at least at home, here this evening. John, the Indians take on the New Haven Nighthawk Club that battled the Indians pretty much to the end before the Indians clinched that final playoff spot last weekend.
Well, the New Haven Nighthawks have been rivals with the Springfield Indians this year. They've met four times in preseason, 10 times during the regular season. And tonight, Mike, the Nighthawks are led by an old familiar face in their lineup. American Hockey League veteran Mark Lofthouse joined the Nighthawks from Europe on February 26th, and since then has registered 2 four-goal games. Here he is right here, played New Haven last year and had 101 points. Back in 1980-81, he had 103 points, his best season as a pro with Hershey, the season that saw him be elected as a first-team All-Star and lead the league in scoring. There he is right there, and in a short period of time, Mark Lofthouse has done big things.
Lofthouse, of course, will be a key member on the right side, replacing a guy that had a lot of problems in his New Haven stint, Blaine Stelton, and we'll tell you all about that as the night progresses. Meanwhile, the Springfield Indians have been bolstered on the left side by a guy that had 44 goals a year ago in the Central Hockey League with a last-place club, the Montana Magic, and has been a magic performer for the Springfield Indians on the left side, John Markle.
Well, John Markle's another one of those players that's come over to Europe during the second half of the season, and since coming to the Springfield Indians, he's really contributed. As you see him right there on your screen, Markle of late has been on fire, 16 goals, 24 assists for 40 points. And this guy has also been a spark plug, stirring things up in the corners for the Springfield Indians. So look for John Markle to get his scoring prowess underway here tonight.
Well, the Indians have made their appearance on the ice, and of course, being the last game of the season, it's awards night here at the center, and the Indians players will be getting their awards from the various people here, the fans and some of the other dignitaries, congratulating and signifying all of the accomplishments for the Springfield Indians this year.
Well, just a fine way to end the regular season here at the Springfield Civic Center and really congratulate this club, which has done an outstanding job, and give them a pat on the back and a little boost heading into the 85 Calder Cup playoffs.
Well, we'll be back with more Springfield Indians hockey and the conclusion of the award ceremony. And we'll be back in just a moment on Continental Cablevision.
Power. Speed. Excitement, emotion. It's wild, it's dramatic, and altogether electrifying. It's the hottest action around when the nation's best meet May 31st through June 9th in Omaha for the 1985 College World Series, an entertainment package you won't want to miss. The preceding message provided by the NCAA.
Welcome, everyone. Mike Barak with John Forslund, and let's go right down to the ice with the Indians general manager Bruce Landon in just a moment. Right now the people on the ice are giving the award for the Batero Lincoln Mercury Award. Now let's go down to Bruce Landon, Springfield Indians general manager, as he will present some more awards to the Springfield Indians players.
Thank you very much, John. Ladies and gentlemen, we are here tonight, of course, along with the players, but also on behalf of the Springfield Indians Hockey Club management, we're also here to honor a man for the past 25 years that has served the Springfield Indians as an official scorer and a supervisor of minor officials. I'd like to now walk up to the ice another man.
Welcome back, everyone. Mike Barrick with John Forslund, Springfield Civic Center. And you caught the good Guy Award for Jim Denver, and also Jim Denver presenting it to the Springfield Indians. We have the awards that were given out to the various players, including the player's player, which was voted on by the Springfield Indians team and given to Chris Pryor. The Unsung Hero Award, which was also given to Chris Pryor, and that was voted on by the Booster Club. The Good Sportsmanship Award was given to Indians right winger Mark Hamway. Players with their first pro goal included Dave Jensen, right wing Alan Kerr, defenseman Vern Smith, defenseman Glenn Johannesson, right winger Jim Archibald, defenseman Miroslav Mali, and center iceman Yuri Poner. Hat tricks this year, defenseman Dave Jensen, right wing Alan Kerr, Hannah Pear, left wing Ken Solheim. The Booster Club Ross Lowe Memorial Trophy for goaltender Mike Sands of the Springfield Indians. Shutouts, Mike Sands had a couple, as did Lauren Mulliken. Larry Carnes of Donan Williams presented the most popular player, and that went to Indians goaltender Mike Sands, as well as the seventh player from Batero Lincoln Mercury, given to Indians right wing Alan Kerr. Did I get all that out all right?
An outstanding job, Mike, and of course, capping it all off, Jimmy Denver being bestowed with the honors here before tonight's game for 25 years of service to the Springfield Indians organization as the head of off-ice officials and official scorer. Sometimes goes unnoticed. We talked with him earlier this year right here on Continental Cable, had him on between periods, and he's just given so much to the Springfield Indians and asked so little in return. It's just great to see such an honor given to him.
Well, now we are going to pause for the playing and singing of our national anthem here at the Springfield Civic Center, the playing of our national anthem, Dan Baruchak on the organ. Here at the Springfield Civic Center, where the Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks will take on here tonight. The Indians coming in 35-39 and 474 points, fourth place in the Southern Division. Starting netminder, as you see, Lauren Mulliken on the season, 11-16, a 4.49 goals against average. On defense for the Indians, Vern Smith and Glenn Johannesson. The forward line, Tim Trimper, along with John Markle and Scott Howson. For the New Haven Nighthawks, there you see the starting netminder, Ron Scott, 13-17-4, 3.80. On defense for New Haven, the youngster Peter Sawkins and Andre Dory, Steve Seguin, Larry Patey, and Jerry Miner, the forward line for the New Haven Nighthawks. And Dory takes over in his own zone. Here is the play now whistled out at the Springfield blue line on an offside. The referee this evening, Mike Noweth. The Indians have a mark of 2 wins, 6 losses, and a tie. When Noweth has refereed the games with the Indians, Joe Calcasola, Dave Butova, the linesman. And again, I had mentioned all those awards, and it was Terry Tate that had picked up the Good Guy Award from Jim Denver. Playing away in the Indians, Vern Smith takes over in his own zone. Clears one into the neutral zone, knocked down by the Hawks and cleared back into the Springfield end of the rink by the youngster Peter Sawkins. Now it's jammed up into the Springfield zone. Indians try and clear it out due to center, and the Hawks have to go back. We're scoreless. We've played 34 seconds into this first period. It's cleared all the way in, and the Indians have to go back. Here is Johannesson up the left side for Tim Trimper, and Trimper up the middle for John Markle, who we previewed to start the game, but Dory covers up and takes over in his own zone. Dory clears up the middle for Jerry Miner. Here's Miner for the Hawks. Teched off by Pryor, the puck ends up skittering over the glass into the penalty box area.
This is the 10th and final time these two clubs will meet this year. The Indians lead the season series between the two clubs, 5 victories, 3 defeats, and a tie, but have lost their last 3 straight to New Haven and are looking to break that record here tonight and snap out of it and get themselves going in a positive fashion for the upcoming playoffs.
Now play in the neutral zone. It's cleared all the way into the Springfield end of the rink, and Chris Pryor back to take over. Here is Pryor, checked in too, but is able to clear one on the near side for Brian Lawton. Up the right wing boards for Jim Archibald. Archibald darts into the New Haven zone, but checked there, and the Hawks take over and clear one up to center ice. Here is New Haven into the Springfield zone. On his backhand and taking over is Dean Kennedy. Kennedy roughed up by Leiter. Altour also in there for the Hawks. Big jam up, and Pryor takes over. We're scoreless in this first period here in Springfield, the Indians' final regular season home contest. And Springfield up the middle, clear for Dale Henry. Here's Henry, turning and twisting, shoots to the New Haven line, where the youngster Dave Lundmark, just up from the Ontario Hockey League, dumps it in. Now on the right side, quick chance of the stop by Malikin on Rob Tudor, who shot one on goal. Puck skitters out the center, and the Indians' Archibald picks it up. Here's Archibald on the far board, just kind of spins and backhands it to the New Haven line, then it's cleared right back. We've played 2 minutes into this first period. It's scoreless as Springfield's Mike Neal tees it up. His shot deflected by Scott Wine of the net, and the Hawks' Dan Brennan takes over. Brennan, the leading scorer on New Haven, leaves it for his own defense, and out come the Hawks to center ice. Into the neutral zone and clearing into the Springfield zone is Mike Guntzel. Backhanded, or it's backed off the backboards along the near side, but held in by Scruton at the left point, then goes outside the line, and the Hawks have to go back. Now along the near boards, the Hawks take over, and Guntzel in his own zone clears all the way to center, and Neal for Springfield is able to clear one, but the Hawks Lofthouse not able to take control, and then Kerr leaves it back for Neal, who gives it up the middle. We're scoreless in this first period. Very close checking first period as the loose puck taken in the neutral zone. Here are the Hawks. Dan Brennan spins around the Indians. Biggs goes into the far side, drops it back for Lofthouse, but checked off there, and Biggs clears to center and into the Hawks end of the rink. New Haven able to backhand one, ends up going up over the glass into the Hawks players' bench.
Now here are the players that are not in the lineup tonight for the Springfield Indians. Two players with injuries. Glenn Hicks, defenseman, still out with a sprained thumb. Ron Handy suffering with a lower back problem. Also not in the lineup here tonight. Center iceman Terry Tate, Mark Hamway, defenseman Miroslav Mali. All not in action tonight for the Springfield Indians, but a couple of new players and one out there right now for Springfield. Back from Indianapolis, center iceman Yuri Poehner seeing action here tonight for Springfield.
And Poehner out there right now with Bob Bodak and Monty Trotche as Johannesson winds it off the boards back behind the net. And Dory for New Haven, able to clear, but held in by Springfield's Bodak on the far side. He's taken out of the play. And now the Hawks break in on right wing. Here's a quick pass into the Springfield zone for Randy Heath. Heath drops it back, but broken up by Springfield. And here comes Poehner into the Hawks zone. Poehner tips it through into the far side for Trotche. Back behind the net for Bodak. Bodak is roughed off back behind the net. Trotche for Springfield. He centers one loose in front, and the stop by Scott on the Indians' Bodak on his backhand. Now it's jammed up along the near board. Springfield's Poehner can't get control, and Heath leads back the other way for New Haven. Into the center ice area. Leaves it through, and the Hawks backman is tied up, and here comes Poehner into the Hawks zone. Spins to make a play. Roughed up and then shoots to the Hawk line where Heath drops it back. We're scoreless first period. We played 4 minutes into the first stanza, and the Hawks take over and clear one on left wing for Heath. Right in, shooting, Malikin goes to his knees, makes a pad save, and out come the try. Here is Vern Smith, slaps it off the boards, then it ends up going over the glass and into the crowd. A very sharp shot down there into the Chiefs.
Well, you got to really look out there for the puck flying off the stick of Vern Smith as it went flying into the crowd. 15:38 remaining here in the first period, just underway. New Haven Nighthawks and the Springfield Indians. The Indians come into tonight's action at home with a record of 23-13-3. Not so good, Mike, as you know, on the road lately. Overall, 12-26-1, but the Indians on the road have been having their problems.
The Indians have lost 11 straight away from the Springfield Civic Center, and of course would like to improve that in that upcoming playoff series against the Whalers.
Well, it's going to be very important, Mike, for the Indians to do well on the road, because in a seven-game series, when you don't have the home ice advantage, you have to win one game in the opponent's building, and that's what the Indians are going to have to do against Binghamton if they are to win four games. So let's hope the Indians will have that going for them in the playoffs, because they'll need it.
On the face-off, the Indians house and backhands it off the boards, and Stuart Smith back to take over. Here is Smith who has it in his own zone, trying to clear one on the boards and is able to take control. Then it's dumped up into the New Haven players bench.
Well, a slow pace action here early on in the first period on Continental Cable. As you see the score flashed on the screen, don't forget Tribe Trivia coming up, our final trivia question of the regular season, and of course we'll continue it throughout the playoffs, but a special treat also here tonight, Mike, with the trivia. The fans will get an opportunity to see a portion, just a portion, of the archives. We have them here tonight, and at one point in the game, you fans are going to have to stay tuned. You're going to actually see part of those talked about archives, which have been mentioned on the radio and here always on Continental Cable all year long.
John, as usual, we strained to get them up here. It took us all afternoon, and that was just for a small portion. Now it's cleared in offside at the Springfield line. It's a little portion that the fans will see. They don't even realize what it took for us to get it up here.
We originally thought we could get the entire archives up to the broadcast booth. That thought was scrapped early once I realized how much a help you were going to be. Then getting them up here, we had to hire a forklift, and we got them up here. Amazing. What a job we did. And the fans will see, and so they got to stay tuned.
Here in the neutral zone, the Hawks take over at clear one to the Indians line, where Markle shoots it free on the right side for Housen. He dipsy doodles and gives it free for Trimper. Trimper holds on to that puck. Centers one in front, but broken up by the Hawks, and out they come on left wing. Steve Seguin puts on the jet, shoots, and Malakin gets a piece of it, deflects wide. And here come the Indians back to center. Markle is tied up there, and the Hawks, Jerry Miner in his own zone, spins to get away from Housen and flips it up the right side. Now the outlet to center ice and shoot one into the Springfield under the rink. Patey ricochets off the backboards where Leiter takes over. We're scoreless. We played 5 minutes, 35 seconds into this first period as Archibald is spun around and Scruton covers up for the Hawks. Now Al Tour slaps one wide of the net. Indians trying to get it out of there. Archibald is checked. Tour's shot goes wide. Tour, very rough and tough player for the Hawks, as Lawton picks up the puck for Springfield. Ahead for Archibald. Across the line, his wrister goes wide, bounces off the backboards on a crazy hop, and then Scott's got to get down and make the stop.
Oh, Ron Scott covering up that loose puck. Let's see if we got that trivia ready to roll here in Continental Cable, and something tells me I got a feeling in my bones we're going to see it here momentarily, and there it is. Tonight's question: what current New York Islander was on the New Haven Nighthawks' first ever regular season roster? What current New York Islander was on the first ever New Haven Nighthawks regular season roster? Tonight's trivia right here on Continental. You had your one guess. You wrote it down. That's it. No more guesses for you. Guess Dennis Potvin, and I know you're trying to scramble for the answer, but that's incorrect.
Play into the New Haven zone, and the Hawks now clear to center ice. Big jam up on the near boards where Tour dumps it in, and Mike Neal has it for Springfield. Tries to get it out of there. Hawks hold it in on the far boards. It's jammed back behind the net where Jensen covers up for Springfield. Here's Dave Jensen, one of the Indians' defensemen. Out of his own zone, outlets on the far side, and out come the Indians. Neal, who shoots it off the boards all the way into the Hawks' zone. We played almost 7 minutes into this first period. Very uneventful first frame. It's very tight checking and a scoreless hockey game at this point. Here is Malakin clearing it off the boards himself. Hawks into forecheck. On the far side, they clear back behind the net. Rob Tudor tries to center one in front. Now pinching in for New Haven is Andre Dorey, the former Springfield Indian, is checked on the play. And Springfield able to recover and clear out to center ice. Here's a lead left wing pass on the far board for Henry. Closing in, shoots! Scott to say, big rebound. Lawton for Springfield gives it free on the far side. Now it's poked up over the glass and into the crowd. On the far side, as play is picking up just a bit.
It is, Mike, and the Springfield Indians, of course, will make the playoffs this year in the American Hockey League, but this is the second year in a row that the New Haven Nighthawks will not have made the playoffs. I'm kind of surprised at the fact that they did not make the playoffs this year, because both you and I felt that on paper, at the beginning of this season, this New Haven team was an outstanding club, playoff bound, but they've had some internal problems this year, and they've had a rough year.
Now it's cleared into the neutral zone where Vern Smith covers up for Springfield. Clears for Alan Kerr, but checked off there in the neutral zone. Then Vern Smith outlets on the left wing boards as Springfield trying to penetrate. And here comes Vern Smith. Spins it through for Kerr, slapping one, but blocked to the defense. Now Kerr in after it. Jams up with Dorey. It's cleared back on the far side, then cleared up over the glass into the crowd. John, we mentioned in the early outset is the fact that Blaine Stoughton is not in the lineup tonight. We heard rumors that he took a two-week golf tour on Florida. I talked to Mike Caron, the trainer of New Haven, says that's not the case, and there have been some questions and feelings that Nick Beverly and Blaine Stoughton have had some fallouts. Whether or not that is true is remains to be seen. Now it's played on the far side, and Lofthouse in his own zone is tied up, clears, but held in by Springfield's Johannesson. To the right side for Kerr. His shot goes wide of the net. The Hawks take over and try and clear one out. Taken by Springfield's Biggs in front. Feeds it through, and Solheim's shot deflects wide. On the near side, Brennan picks it up. The rookie sensation, Brennan, clears to center, and Johannesson for Springfield into the Hawks zone. Is able to carry one off the boards, and New Haven take over. We have 11:55 left first period. It's scoreless as New Haven on the attack. Here's a chance for Lofthouse right on, and Mullican is able to glove it and hold on.
11:47 remaining in the first period. There's the Springfield goaltender, Lauren Mullican, who's been missing from that Springfield lineup for about a week and a half. As we're going to take a look as he stops the shot and seeing his first action in that period of time here tonight at the Civic Center from Mark Lofthouse, a blast from just inside the blue line. And Mike, getting back to the New Haven situation, Nick Beverly, it's been a long year for him behind the bench for New Haven. A lot of reports of internal problems with a lot of the veteran players rebelling this year. And you know, New Haven had an excellent opportunity to make the playoffs when the Indians were going through their losing slump. New Haven themselves were in the driver's seat up in the Maritime provinces. Couldn't muster a victory a couple of weeks back as they lost on six or seven occasions. It's hurt them, and there's been a lot of internal behind-the-scenes problems through reports with Nick Beverly, the kind of year he'd like to forget.
The Hawks are gone 15-25-3 since the 1st of January, 10 games under the 500 mark. Here's Poehner, a shot right on, stick by Scott, and he holds on and makes the save. Scott, by the way, with that mark of 13-17-4, has gone 3-1 against the Indians, including winning the last three games that the Hawks have beaten the Drive.
That's exactly right. Ron Scott has played quite well for New Haven over the course of the last three games, and New Haven has, after some early season problems with the Springfield Indians, New Haven not getting off to a great start against the Tribe, with winless in six attempts, the Indians picking up the first five and tying a game in the process. So Ron Scott has taken over and backboned this New Haven team, and now they've turned things around against Springfield at least.
Now playing the Hawk zone, they're able to clear one to center and deep into the Springfield zone, and hustling back after it is number five, Ken Leiter. Here is Leiter in his own zone on the right side for Pryor. Pryor is taken out of the play. Hawks in a forecheck, taking over is Heath. Gives it free for Backman. Big tie up in the loose puck taken by Trotche for Springfield. Here is Trotche in his own zone. Outlets for Leiter, and Leiter leads an attack to center. For Yuri Poehner to flex one into the Hawk zone. Bouncing puck and taken by New Haven. They try and clear one, and do succeed into the center ice area. Here comes New Haven. Backman, pass for Kontos, across the line, but it's offside at the Springfield Indian blue line.
Well, through the first half of this first period, it's been a slow-paced first period. Neither club getting those great scoring chances on either goaltender, although there's been some action in both ends. A couple of long-range shots on Lauren Mullican and on the New Haven net. As you take a look at the Indians bench, Ron Scott's just have to cover up on the loose puck. The Indians trying to forecheck against the Nighthawks and create something in their own end. But 10:46 remaining in the first period, and we still have no score.
Here's a quick backhander on the far side, clear to the Springfield line where Neal is able to dump one to center. Then it's cleared right back in. Over 10 minutes remaining in this first period. We're still scoreless here in Springfield. It's Markle in his own zone. Lead pass to Trimmer, bouncing puck, then slapped into the Hawks end of the rink, and New Haven have to go back. Now Markle in a forecheck for Springfield. He's checked on the play. Now it's held in by House. Centered for Markle, dipsy doodling. Feeds it through for Trimmer. Trimmer right in. Delayed penalty coming up against New Haven. Six attackers as Mullican is out. And as soon as the Hawks take over, a penalty coming up, our first against New Haven. Now we have some pushing and shoving in front of Ron Scott. And a couple of players have some words there. John Markle, Larry Patey, and also Brian Lawton is in there as well. And now we're going to have a penalty called against New Haven.
Jerry Miner was the guy jamming with John Markle. He gets the penalty for slashing here with 10:06 remaining. Let's see it again right here and see if we can pick it out. There it is, a vicious two-hander by Miner across the back of John Markle. And we mentioned John Markle in the pregame show as we profiled him and showed that he has been scoring a lot of goals of late for the Springfield Indians. There's a good look at him, but he's also been a spark plug in the corners, stirring things up, and has been involved in some fisticuffs, which is uncharacteristic for him. Last week against Nova Scotia, he was involved in a couple of fights with Mark Hapscheid, and in Friday night's game at the Springfield Civic Center, also got himself involved in another altercation against the Maine Mariners. So John Markle mixing things up, although he doesn't have the reputation for being the tough guy.
Well, I guess they're going to call a five-minute major for slashing. He may have drawn blood on John Markle, and as a result, the five-minute major is called. So the Indians will have a power play chance for the remaining 5 minutes, or actually the next 5 minutes. Springfield on the power play this year, as you see, 71-306, 23.2%. And against the Hawks this year, have gone 8 for 29 and a mark of 27.6% with the man advantage against New Haven.
Well, the Springfield Indians power play has come a long way since the beginning of the year. Every week seems to be creeping up, and now is at a respectable 23%. And also, Mike, on this five-minute major, another one of those penalties where the Indians can score as many goals as they want on a five-minute major, and the manpower advantage will stay throughout the remaining portion of the 5 minutes. New Haven will not get the man back should the Indians score.
Now play into the center ice area, and the loose puck taken by Solheim. Now Solheim clears for Markle. Markle in the center ice area leads it on the left wing side for Housen. Housen trying to dipsy doodle through. It's jammed up on the far side. Solheim for Springfield. Able to clear one back behind the net, but the loose puck taken by New Haven and cleared out all the way to center where the Indians have to go back. And then as soon as the Indians touch it, it's rolled down on a high stick.
Well, the Indians still plenty of time left in this penalty here. 4:28 to the call to minor, 9:33 in the period. Lauren Henning has an opportunity here to use two or three combinations as he well would like to on the power play, see which one works with plenty of time to work with it, although the Indians now face with the faceoff in their own end. But a good chance for Springfield to get things rolling. It's been a slow pace first period, and on this power play, they can pick it up a little bit, get some momentum going, see if they can get as many goals as possible against New Haven.
Well, the faceoff in the Springfield zone to the right of the Indians' goal, and Lauren Mullican. Faceoff controlled, and Scruton leaves it to the right point. Quick shot right on goal. Mullican able to glove it and hold on.
Well, quick shot taken there, right? No problem for Lauren Mullican as he fielded it down for Springfield. We're going to see the replay right here. It's going to be interesting to see how Lauren Mullican is in tonight's game. He hasn't seen much action. He's been away from the club, and coming back tonight, we'll have to see if he's a little bit rusty. He was a red-hot goaltender at one point for the Springfield Indians, and an important part of this two-goalie system, which has been employed by Lauren Henning, the coach of the Indians, for the second half of this season. But of course, it's going to be interesting to see what happens to the Indians' goaltenders now. One of them, either Sands or Mullican, has to get hot going into the playoffs.
Now it's cleared into the New Haven zone. Indians in a forecheck, and the loose puck taken back behind the net. They jam up and hold it there behind the net and freeze it up there.
9:11 remaining now, and the Indians have a chance here to get something started. They have really not tested Ron Scott as of yet on this power play opportunity. A lot of time to get things going, but let's hope the Indians don't get too tentative and take too much time, because before you know it, this power play will be up.
Now the Hawks on the left side. Here's Lofthouse closing in. Lofthouse in front, but checked away, and then Archibald on the far side leaves it for the Indians' Leiter. Here's Leiter in his own zone for Springfield. To center ice, knocked down by Lofthouse, and then Leiter leaves it for his own defense for Vern Smith on the left side for Leiter. Now Leiter at center, slaps it into the Hawks zone, caroms off the backboards and taken by the Hawks, and Stuart Smith able to clear one all the way to center and deep into the Springfield zone, and now the Indians have to go back. Here is Vern Smith in his own zone for Springfield. Taking over and able to clear one on the left side for Leiter, and here comes Vern Smith for the Tribe. Here is Smith in the center ice area, slapping it in. Now it goes back behind the net, and the Hawks take over and are able to clear one out the center where Housen has it for Springfield. Here's Housen, who has 10 points this year against the Hawks. Up the right side for Kerr. Kerr leaves it for Markle. Markle is checked off by Heath. Big jam up on the near side. They fight for it, and New Haven able to clear the zone. We have just 2:50 left in this penalty as the Hawks try and clear one on the left side. Here's Heath, jams up along the boards, and then here's a break for Springfield, but broken up by Kontos on right wing. Shooting, and that deflects wide. New Haven, shorthanded, but doing very well with a man down. They quickly try and center one. Loose and in front of the goal, and then Bodak covers up behind the net and takes over. 2 minutes, 26 seconds left in the minor slashing penalty as Springfield's Bodak controls. Bodak across the line, but it's offside at the Hawk blue line.
Well, an uneventful power play thus far for the Springfield Indians. almost halfway through this opportunity. 2:19 remaining on the penalty to Jerry Miner. He got it for slashing as he really put the hammer to the Indians' John Markle, and that's why the penalty was called. But the Indians have not had a scoring chance as of yet. I don't think they've had a shot on goal on Ron Scott during this man advantage thus far. It's been New Haven that's carried the play. Good scoring chance for Chris Kontos as he intercepted a pass prior to the shot he took that was intended for Bob Bodak. He would have been in free on the play. Jensen had him set up perfectly, but Kontos back-checked nicely, intercepted the puck, came back the other way, and created his own scoring chance. So with 2 minutes remaining on the power play, let's see what Springfield can do.
Kontos has burned the Indians for 10 points with 6 goals this year. And the Indians clear it in offside at the Hawks line. And the fans don't like it, John.
Well, the fans, the natives, are getting restless here at the Springfield Civic Center. They were not very happy with the effort the club turned in on Friday night against the Maine Mariners. They know that the playoffs loom in the future, and they want to see the Indians start to play playoff hockey. And they're getting a little bit impatient here with this excellent chance for the Indians to get a couple of goals, and thus far haven't even got a shot on goal.
Here are the Hawks clearing, went all the way down. Malakin able to leave it for Dave Jensen. Here's Jensen out of his own zone, clearing to the neutral zone, and Housen picks up the loose puck. Spinning on the left side, pulls up, surveys the traffic, holds on to that puck. Now on the far side, leaves it back behind the net. Now Tripper shooting, loose in front, Solheim a whack at it, but here come the Hawks on the attack. Here is a lead left wing pass into the Springfield zone. Backman is taken out of the play at the Indians' defense by Jensen, and then it's wound off the far side for Tim Tremper. Here's Tremper in his own zone. Forecheck. Now New Haven trying to center one. Backman a poke at it. Cleared away in Solheim with just over a minute to go in the penalty. Here's Solheim slapping one off the boards. On is it. Wine free. Indians holding it at the point. Here is the quick centering pass. Loose in front. Solheim can't get his stick on it. Then the Hawks are able to clear it away. And here's Housen in his own zone. Housen gives for Vern Smith, who spins back in his own zone. And here comes Smith for Springfield. Ahead on the left wing side as the Indians lose control, and Lofthouse breaks back, shoots. Oh, and he missed the net as he had one labeled. Now on the near side, Indians can't get control of the puck as the Hawks wheel and deal in their own zone.
A lot of problems for the Springfield Indians organizational-wise. They could not get anything started that last time. Vern Smith coughed the puck up to Mark Lofthouse. Careless trying to break that puck into the New Haven end. And it's the New Haven Nighthawks have had a couple of scoring chances on this power play, and the Indians have not.
Here's Kerr now leading the attack on right wing. Kerr for Springfield, trying to get one through. Leaves it back for Archibald. Archibald is pinched by the Hawks on the near side. Dahlman, then it's shot all the way down. Just 12 seconds left in this 5 minute power play chance. Now Springfield on left wing, clearing one for the far side as Markle dumps it back behind the net. Archibald then after it. Now Markle on the far boards, takes control. Miner is back on. The Hawks have killed it off, and here's Patey. Lead pass for Miner, too far ahead, goes all the way down, and Malakin is able to wind one on the left wing side. Indians, as you mentioned, John, very disorganized on that power play. Now New Haven back behind the net, trying to center one. Vern Smith ties up a Hawk player, then it's picked up along the near boards. New Haven trying to wheel and deal. They get it back to the point, dump one through, but here's Kerr for Springfield, able to shoot to center. Here are the Hawks. Dory back into the Springfield zone. On the far side, nifty passing play. It's shot out right on net, and the stop by Malakin after some dandy passing work by the Hawks. Miner and Dory, and Malakin was able to make the stop.
Well, Lauren Malakin very sharp. If we can see it again, top of your screen, a beautiful pass there. Jerry Miner to Steve Seguin. Seguin takes the wrist shot from just inside the faceoff circle, and quick with the pad, Lauren Malakin right there to cover up the puck. No New Haven player in sight as far as picking up the rebound, and Lauren Malakin was quick to cover up on it. We have 4:29 remaining as you look at Nick Beverly, the coach of the New Haven Nighthawks, here in the first period. Still no score between the Springfield Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks.
Face off in the Springfield zone to the left of Malakin. Here's Dory shooting one right on, and the stop by Malakin, and he's able to make the save.
Andre Dory, who played in Springfield back in 1981-82, gets a blast right off the faceoff right here. Doesn't waste any time with it as he one-times the puck without stopping it, and the shot comes a riser right into the chest protector of Lauren Malakin.
Dory, of course, also up with the parent Rangers, also with St. Louis of the NHL. Here's a quick shot. Malakin the save. Now it's loose in front. Hawks try and hold on to that puck on the far side. Peter Sawkins. Sawkins is checked up on the play. Now it's loose in front, and as soon as Pryor touches it, a penalty coming up this time against the Indians.
Well, interference is the call by Mike Noeth, and that'll be the first power play opportunity of the evening coming up for the New Haven Nighthawks. The Indians defenseman Glenn Johannesson gets the call here with 4:12 remaining in the first period as he interfered with a couple of New Haven players in front who were creating some havoc for goaltender Lauren Mulliken. Johannesson moved them out of the way and in the process picked up an interference call.
Well, the Indians have to face a Hawk power play this year that has gone 66 for 285, 23.2%, not bad. But listen to this stat against the Indians. They've gone 11 for 32, 34.4% with the man advantage against Springfield this year. So the Indians will have their hands full on this one. Here is planned away and Jensen for Springfield. Can't get it out. Hawks are able to dump back to the far side, but Neal plays one off the boards all the way down, and the Hawks have to go back. Johannesson off for interference. The time of the penalty, 15:48 into this scoreless first period. And out the center come the Hawks. Here's Dean Kennedy slapping one into the Springfield zone. Altor, a poke at it. Loose puck behind the net. Now it's scrambled on the far side. Hawks are able to take control. Here's Big Kennedy. Takes over far side. Kennedy drops it to the point for Dory. Dory now for New Haven. Tries to center one for Kennedy. Right in, shoots, and it's blocked for the defense. Now Kennedy on the far side, taken out of the play by Neal. Loose puck taken by the Hawks. They try and center one, but Lawton can't get it out. Hawks hold it in at the point. Here's a chance for New Haven. They quickly shoot one in front, but Mulliken the stop after it was let go from Kontos at the right side and then deflected through traffic.
Well, through the first portion of this power play, interesting unit put out there by Coach Nick Beverly. You're going to see some of the action right here. The front line of Dean Kennedy, Al Tour, and Rob Tudor. And on defense, Andre Dory and Chris Kontos. Not the usual power play unit we've seen this year for the New Haven Nighthawks, but Beverly trying to stir things up with a little muscle up front. Of course, Danny Brennan, Randy Heath have been big members of this power play. They're out there right now for New Haven. And of course, earlier in the year, Billy O'Dwyer, who's not in the action tonight due to injury, and Blaine Stout were also big parts in the New Haven power play.
Now it's cleared on the right side. Quick shot wide by Brennan. Now at the left point, Seguin takes over. Seguin out of the LA Kings organization. Gives for Lofthouse. Back to Seguin at the left point. Tees it up, shoots. Mulliken gets a piece of it. Big rebound. And Springfield taking control. And Tripper able to wheel one outside the line and deep to center where Seguin takes over. Seguin leads a Nighthawk attack to Brennan on the far side. Pulls up, surveys the traffic, holds on to that puck. Brennan on the far side. Still holding on to that puck. Wheels and deals. Tries to make a play. Feeds side of the net for Loftus in front. Deflected, and Mulliken got a piece of that. Then cleared away by Springfield and all the way down.
Good play by the Springfield Indians defense clearing that puck. New Haven, with time running out on their power play, has had a couple of chances.
Here's Brennan winding one back behind the net and lighter for Springfield. Clears one outside the line, and the Hawks have to go back. The New Haven Nighthawks, Kontos, or rather Seguin in his own zone, up the middle, and here comes Rob Tudor, the veteran Tudor across the line. Time running out, Johannesson is back on, Springfield has killed it off, and the Hawks have to go back. We're scoreless, 2:06 left in this first period, as the Indians tip one for Markle, ahead on the right side for Kerr, but offside at the Nighthawk line. Very interesting game here, scoreless at this point.
Well, each team has traded off power play chances. The Indians a little bit more major than, let's say, the New Haven Nighthawks, and of course it was on the penalty side of the ledger, a major slashing call, 5 minutes to Jerry Miner, killed off by the Springfield Indians, by New Haven, and then the Indians come right back and kill off a power play chance for New Haven with some good defensive work in their own zone as a youngster. Waving to you, Mike, with that big hand. Kid's got big hands for a little guy.
Now the Hawks take over, and up the center ice is Heath, who leaves it back for Scruton with under 2 minutes to go in this first period. Here is a pass into the far side. Leiter for Springfield trying to get it out. Now Solheim picks it up for Springfield, and out come the Tribe. Solheim is met at the Hawks line, and then on left wing, the Indians' Kerr races in after it, digs it free on the far side. He tries to center one, but Kontos rakes it up and leaves it for his own defense. Out the left wing side comes Randy Heath. Headmans to center, but broken up by Poner, who leaves it back for his own defense with just over a minute to go in this first frame. Here's Poner. Errant pass picked off by New Haven, then dropped back for their own defense where the newcomer, Lundmark, clears to the Springfield line. And now in the neutral zone, Backman leaves it for his own defense, and then it's cleared all the way on the left wing side and out to center. Kontos across the line. He's checked, and Neal for Springfield, clearing it right back into the Hawks end of the rink, and New Haven have to go back. Under a minute to go now in this first period. No scores. The Hawks clear one all the way into the Springfield zone, and Pryor has to go back. Now Springfield trying to get it out. Held in by New Haven. Dumped back to the top of the circle, but wheeled back outside the line, and the Hawks, Dory, has to go back. He's able to backhand one off the boards for Patey. Patey, who beat the Indians in overtime in New Haven, trying to get one through. It's again right in, shooting, and blocked the defense, and the puck skitters to center. And now we have an injured player in front of the Indians' goal, that it's Chris Pryor getting up slowly. Out comes Eddie Tyberski quickly to attend to the Indians' intense defenseman, Chris Pryor.
Well, the Indians can't afford to lose any defenseman, especially this man right here, Chris Pryor. Watch the shot by Seguin as it hits Pryor right on the kneecap. You're going to see it right here. Wrist shot by the left winger for the New Haven Nighthawks, and right there, that hurts. Right on the kneecap as Chris Pryor, one of the best shot blockers on this Springfield Indians club, always goes down in front of the puck and works on that in practice quite often. And he gets up under his own power after being tended to by the Indians trainer Eddie Tyberski. And let's hope Pryor's back in action. Glenn Hicks not in the lineup for Springfield on defense. And earlier on the road trip this week, Vern Smith is seeing action here tonight, but he's been out for quite some time. And defense is one area you're going to need when you head to the playoffs.
Here in the neutral zone is Dory. Wheels it cross ice as the Hawks clear into the Springfield zone with just 12 seconds to go in this first period. Now Malakin winds it on the left side for Bodak, who's able to shoot the center where Patey has control. He and Archibald fight for it. 4 seconds left in the period. Bodak on left wing, 2 seconds to go. He's met at the defense, and the buzzer sounds signaling the end of the first period. And both teams skate off without a goal. It's scoreless.
Well, to say this period was intense would definitely not be true. Neither club playing very intense at this point, although the Indians had a couple of chances. The one time they could have really put it to the New Haven Nighthawks on that five-minute major to minor, they did not getting too many shots on goal during that power play opportunity. New Haven had the bulk of the scoring chances, although there weren't too many glaring ones. Lauren Malakin played solid for Springfield, but the Indians nor the Nighthawks, very intense through one. But the Indians are the club in the playoffs, and look for them to pick up the pace in the upcoming two periods.
Shots on goal in the first period, the Hawks 13 and the Indians 6. We'll take a look at what's happening in the American Hockey League, down with just 2 games remaining. And we'll also take a look at the American Hockey League playoffs with American Hockey League Vice President Gordy Anziano. The score, no score. We'll be back in just a moment.
The NCAA Women's Championships offer a highway to successful opportunities, challenging competition, excellent education, victories and medals, friendship and team spirit. This and more can be seen at any of the 34 NCAA Women's Championships. Get involved with college athletics. Attend an NCAA championship this season. For dates and sites, write NCAA Championships, Box 1906, Mission, Kansas, 66201.
Welcome back. And one Mike Barrick with John Forslund. After one period of play, the Springfield Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks deadlocked here in the first frame in our second to last intermission before the playoffs start.
Well, Mike, I can't believe the season's come to a close here tonight on Continental Cable. Looking forward to those playoffs, but gee, this year's flown right by.
John, the Indians scoreless in that first period, but we're going to get right to what's happening in the American Hockey League, some of the late statistics and what's going to happen in the upcoming playoffs, at least right now, what we can tell.
Well, only one day remaining in the regular season as this game is taped. Of course, when the game is viewed by our folks at home, the season will be over and everybody else will know what's going on, but right now we're in the dark about it. So let's take a look at those standings. First of all, in that exciting Northern Division, and throw them all up in a hat and try to pick one out here, because, Mike, it's anybody's game.
all kinds of combinations, and you and Gordy Anziano will discuss those in just a few moments. However, the one thing that is for sure, the Maine Mariners have clinched first place and clinched a playoff spot in the Northern Division. The Moncton Golden Flames are definitely out. So between Fredericton, Adirondack, Nova Scotia, and Sherbrooke, one of those four teams will be knocked out. Who's to say right now, when the fans watch the game on Monday night, they will know which one is not in. It will be one of those four.
Well, as I mentioned, Mike, it's anybody's picking right now, and it's up to those clubs to go up against each other and determine their own destiny. We'll just have to wait and see what happens. And whatever the case, the four that make it, it's going to be exciting playoffs in the North.
Yeah, Earl Jessamine of the Fredericton Express said that whatever team does make it out of those four, the three teams that do, they'll all be primed up because they've been playing their best hockey down the stretch to try and make the playoffs. Taking a look at the Southern Division standings, and there you see the top four teams that will be meeting in round one of the American Hockey League playoffs beginning this Wednesday night. The Binghamton Whalers, first place, clinching with 111 points, John. They have an offensive club. They scored 8 goals the other night. And, of course, are featuring Paul Gardner, who set an American Hockey League record, which we'll get to in just a moment. So Binghamton against the Indians in round one, and then also Baltimore and Rochester in the other Southern Division matchup.
Well, these playoff matches should be interesting. The Indians, I think, Mike, can find the hole in the Binghamton Whalers, hopefully, and find the formula to beat them in round number one. And, of course, Baltimore playing outstanding hockey during the latter stretches of the month of March. And, of course, here the first week in April, looks like one of the top clubs in the league going up against a club like Rochester, which has been great all year long. So these matchups, and, of course, we'll be talking with Gordy Anziano about them, look like dandies.
And one other note, Hershey, that, of course, has 63 points. They have been playing extremely well under Bill Barber. They only lost 2 games in their last 8. And although the games don't mean much late in the season, they've really put on a good show under Bill Barber. Taking a look at the top scorers in the American Hockey League, and there you see them all. And of course, Paul Gardner, the one the Indians will face in the first round of the playoffs. Gardner broke that American Hockey League record set. Another of the Ross Shades had 126 points. Gardner broke that, the all-time leading scorer for one season in the American Hockey League history.
What's phenomenal about this, Mark, Mike, is his games played, just 63 games played to date, not playing a full season with Binghamton because he's been down, rather up to the Washington Capitals on 2 occasions this year, a phenomenal record for Paul Gardner.
Taking a look at the Indians' top scorers, and there you see Ron Handy in the lead, 29 goals, 35 assists, 64 points. And what's very interesting for the Indians are going to have at least 5 players with 20 goals and also have a chance for 3 more if Bob Bodak, who has 19, there, Terry Tate with 19 as well, and John Markle, who has 16. So if those three players could get some role here in the second and third period tonight and on Sunday night against Sherbrooke when the teams have met, there's a possibility of 8 players on the Indians with 20 or more goals.
It's balanced scoring when you talk about that fact, of course. 8 with 20, just balanced team scoring, what it's been all year long.
Now taking a look at the upcoming games in the American Hockey League playoffs. We have the Indians in Binghamton for games 1 and 2 on April 10th and 12th, beginning at 7:30. You fans have a chance to pick up the action and see the game here in Springfield next Saturday, April 13th, when the Whalers and Indians take on in Game 3, and then Game 4 of the action between the Indians and the Whalers will be on Tuesday night, April 16th. But this week, 3 games on tap, 2 in Binghamton and 1 in Springfield, round 1 of the playoffs.
Well, it's going to be exciting, Springfield and Binghamton, and stay tuned to Continental Cable for all the playoff action right here every week.
Hope you're enjoying the action tonight, scoreless between the Indians and the Hawks. American Hockey League Vice President Gordy Anziano is John's guest to tell you all about the upcoming American Hockey League playoffs, Calder Cup playoffs, coming right up.
Exerskate just for the health of it at the Springfield Olympia Ice and Roller Sports Center, your year-round sports facility. You can enjoy ice and roller skating as well as indoor soccer and floor hockey. The Springfield Olympia Ice and Roller Center has a full skate and pro shop, so you'll find what you're looking for. From amateurs to experts and anyone in between, a complete snack bar will satisfy that athletic appetite. For birthday parties, club get-togethers, or special occasions, renting a rink is the fun way to throw a party. And it's as easy as the Springfield Olympia Sports Center, conveniently located at exit 13 off I-91.
Where We're back good between trip, periods here. We almost had a little bit of an injury in the booth, but our floor manager, Peter Fratini, almost took a nosedive. But let's get to the interview with our vice president of the American Hockey League, Gordy Anziano. What a way to start things off,
that's
Gordy.
Yep.
First of all, I want to compliment you on that sport jacket. A breath of fresh air as far as spring is concerned. It's a beautiful... Peter Cooney said you won the Masters with that sport jacket.
Oh, no, I didn't win it. It's green, and it is a Masters jacket, but I didn't win it. I bought it in a... Five and dime in Augusta.
Well, anyway, talking about spring, the playoffs are upon us right now. Springfield, yeah. Binghamton, round number one. As we talk about this series, we're going to show the fans the playoff dates and what's going to happen. It looks like a dandy.
I think so. I think that a lot of people might be willing to write off the Indians going against the Binghamton Whalers. Obviously, Binghamton's had a hell of a season. They won the most points. They've had a great season, but I do think that they can be taken either by Springfield or by another club. So I certainly wouldn't write the Indians off, give them a chance. They could win one in Binghamton in that first two, and I think they really got a road to hoe, and they could do it.
Well, a lot of the fans might be panicking right now. The Indians not playing the great hockey, but of course, when the playoffs come around, it sort of gets guys aroused a lot of times, and certain guys rise to the occasion. Hopefully mm-hmm. that's going to happen here in Springfield.
I've seen it happen many years, John. It is a new season. We call it the second season. Actually, I call it the second season. You have the regular season, the playoff season, and then what we call the rumor season. And the rumor season this year is kind of slow because there's no expansion talk or no rumors about people moving one place or another. The playoffs are our showcase. It's the best teams over the 520-game schedule, and anything can happen. I think Maine winning the Cup last year is a good example of that. Certainly Rochester, heavily favored, going into that final series. We had written the Mariners off, and yet they came around and took the silver home with them.
Talk about showcasing two teams. What about that Baltimore-Rochester series? Those two clubs have had streaky years all year long, but near the top the entire season. Should be a great one.
I think it is going to be a great one. I think personally I'd have to favor Baltimore. They've come on very strong at the end of the year. John, I've always said over the years, and I've witnessed and given the cup away, or at least assisted Mr. Butterfield in giving the cup away now for 17 years, and the team that has the best or the hot goaltender in the playoffs in a short series is really the team you have to watch. And Baltimore right now, with Casey and Dion, as a genuine backup. It's nice to have a backup goaltender that was once in the NHL All-Star team. I think I have to favor Baltimore in that series.
Now the all-important question. Now this game's broadcast on Monday night and the season will be concluded.
Thank goodness.
I'm going to call upon you to be the soothsayer and look at that Northern Division and try to determine who's going to make the playoffs, because right now it's you throw them up in a hat and see what happens.
Okay, Maine's going to make the playoffs. That's about as far
Thank
as
you.
I'm willing
Thank
to go.
You. You've enlightened me
they,
so far.
They clinched the division title and a playoff berth all in one night, which is very unusual, and I think most of the fans that have been tuned into the American League realize that we're looking at a situation where the second-place team has 78 points, the third-place team has 78 points, fourth-place team has 75, and Moncton is out, unfortunately, so they're not going to make it. The games tonight will have a great bearing on it. I honestly think that we're going to be looking at making the final pairings probably Sunday night after all the games are over. But as far as who's going to make it, one of those four teams will.
All right, if you won't go out on a limb on that, from the league office standpoint now, if there's a tie, what happens? And it very well could be.
Well, if there's a tie between two clubs, first of all, when we talk about ties, we're talking about tie in points. Mm-hmm. The first tiebreaker is the number of games won. Now, if we go from that point, they tied there. Then we go to the season series between the two clubs. And if it's still tied, we have a series of tiebreakers all the way down to, God forbid, a flip of a coin, which we certainly wouldn't want to do. But we're even, to complicate the situation even more, John, we're in a situation where we could have three teams tied. So in order to break a tie between three teams, we eliminate the season series things, of course, because you're involving three teams in it, and then go strictly to, say, goals, most goals in the regular season, least amount of goals, and then again, as I say, God forbid we should get to a flip of a coin.
Gordy, this has been a great year for the American Hockey League. We're looking forward to the playoffs. They look like they're going to be outstanding, with every matchup being quite exciting. But after the cup is given away, looking toward next year, what's in the future for the league? Anything new? There's been some rumors about new franchises popping up in the American Hockey League. Anything you can fill the fans in now at this point?
Well, to start on solid ground, I can tell you that all 13 teams that I know of will be back. Okay, we're even at a point now where each of the 13 member clubs have submitted their dates. Mr. Butterfield is ready to start putting pins in the board, and by that I mean he's going to make the schedule. All we need now is approval from the teams to go with the same scheduling format and scheduling sectors that we've used for the last couple of years. There is a group of people, two groups I believe, maybe even three, people who are very seriously interested in landing a franchise for the Utica building, which has for the last few years, the Mohawk Valley Stars have been greatly interested. They've been competing in the North Atlantic, North American League. Whether or not they can get a franchise in the league really depends on a lot of things, but the major key for them is can they get an NHL support. Now, at the present time, there's only two clubs in the NHL who are not involved in the American League, that being Chicago and St. Louis. They'd have to make some sort of a tie-up there or get somebody to, say, move out of a dual affiliation to work with them. Without that NHL affiliation, I just don't hold much hope for them.
There's some talk now the Chicago Blackhawks might be coming back to the American Hockey League in Halifax. Anything to that?
That's part of the rumor season I was mentioning, John. I know of no efforts there, although the league office would not necessarily have to be privy to that fact. The Chicago people may have made an agreement with Edmonton to put their players in there as a dual affiliation. The franchise is owned by Edmonton, so that could be done. That does not require league approval, so it may in fact be true, but if it is, we have not been advised of it.
Gordy, this game broadcast on Monday night. Wednesday night, the Indians open the playoffs against the Binghamton Whalers in Binghamton. The dates are being shown right now.
Mm-hmm.
What makes playoff hockey? Of course, the National Hockey League with the Stanley Cup, the flavor is there naturally. But in this American Hockey League, there's something about playoff hockey that for the fans is just something special. It's a whole different type of game. What makes it special?
Well, I think it's the second season. We've been criticized. I think all professional sports have to a certain extent that we make the regular season useless by making so much or putting so much emphasis on the playoffs. There's short series. There's big money involved in the playing of the games, and I think the combination of those two, you've got to win. There is no tomorrow. Seven games is a very short series, and I think that really puts the flavor into it.
Well, Gordy, thanks for coming on. Look forward to those playoffs and hope everything works out for the entire league, not just the Indians. We'd love to see the Indians defeat Binghamton, but let's have it successful for the American Hockey League.
Thank you very much.
Gordy Anziano, the vice president of the American Hockey League, has been our guest. Back with more Springfield Indians hockey right after this.
Speed, excitement, emotion. It's wild, it's dramatic, and altogether electrifying. It's the hottest action around when the nation's best meet May 31st through June 9th in Omaha for the 1985 College World Series, an entertainment package you won't want to miss. The preceding message provided by the NCAA.
Welcome back, everyone. Mike Barrick with John Forslund back in Springfield. It's scoreless between the Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks. We're in the second period, just starting off. And on the left side, the Hawks try and clear one in front. Quick scoring chance. Malkin grabs the player, cutting in on the left side and makes a sensational save on Seguin down the left wing boards. And a sparkling, spellbounding stop.
Well, we got to start things off with a bang here in the second period. Just 19-12 remaining just into the second period. And Lauren Malkin makes a beautiful glove save here on Steve Seguin as he breaks in trying to get New Haven's first goal of the game. Seguin with 17 goals on the year, only 7 assists for 24 points. But he can put the puck in the net from time to time. And he had a great chance on the goaltender Malkin.
Face off in the circle to the right of Malkin. Malkin has dropped his last 6 outings and has dropped 5 games under the 500 mark as far as his record goes. Now it's cleared in offside at the Springfield line.
Well, of course, this week the Springfield Indians open up their playoffs, and the parent teams of the Springfield Indians will also open up their playoffs in the National Hockey League. The New York Islanders will be taking on the Washington Capitals and the Minnesota North Stars. Not known as we broadcast here who they'll be playing. It's either going to be St. Louis or Chicago. It's probably going to be St. Louis, but we'll just have to wait and see on that. But we'll keep the fans abreast of all the action as the parents. We wish them best of luck in the National Hockey League playoffs.
Now play back into the far corner, and the Hawks are able to clear one out the center and deep into the center ice area where Neal caroms it off the boards to the Hawks line. We're scoreless in this first frame as Springfield slapped one all the way down, deflected by Scott, then he just catches one, leaves it back for his own defense. New Haven in their own zone. Stuart Smith winds it up the right side, and here come the Hawks into the center ice area. Rob Tudor into the Springfield zone. Cross ice pass on the left wing side, then it's deflected over the glass and into the crowd. John, I just want to thank George Grandy and Stan Seven for his nightly broadcast water from the Stand 7. They always fill me up here with the cup coming down at the end of each period. Want to thank George and also our concession crew of Ted Warzecki and Tony King that have provided me with my relish on the hot dogs.
And of course, I get absolutely nothing out of this deal. You always come up with a cup of water. I get nothing, and I'm the guy who's talking throughout the entire intermission with the interviews, but that's all right. And I'd like to thank all those guys also downstairs because they're great guys, and even though I don't ask for anything from time to time, I do know them, and they do a super job here at the Springfield Civic Center. Keeping you filled is a big chore.
May I interrupt? Of course, John doesn't mention the fact that I always offer to bring him something, and he always says, don't bring anything. Of course, now makes it sound like I never do him any favors. So
you
folks have to decide for yourselves what actually is happening up here. Now it's cleared in offside at the Springfield line.
I don't think that's an answerable question to figure out what's happening up here. You never know what's going to happen up here in the broadcast booth with the two of us, and we know that's been true in our Continental Cable broadcasts, which have been outstanding, and this one has 18-10 remaining in the second period. No score between the Springfield Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks.
A face-off just outside the blue line to the left of Springfield netminder Lauren Mullican. On the face-off, it's cleared back into the Springfield end of the rink. Now on the far side, Lofthouse covers up. On the far boards, Mark Lofthouse gives it for Dan Brennan. Feeds it to the side of the net as the Hawks wheel it back to the point for Mike Gunsel. But the Indians break back on left wing. Here's Bodak spinning through. His wrister is blocked by the defense. Bodak, who has 11 points this year against the Hawks. Here's Pryor spinning in front for Trotche. Shoots, and a skate save by Scott. And the rebound taken by the Hawks and cleared to the Springfield line. Slapped by Poner in front of the net. Bodak, backhander, scores! Bob Bodak with a neat backhand from in front beats Scott. And with 17:34 remaining second period, the Indians lead 1-0.
Number 27, Bob Bodak, becomes the sixth 20-goal scorer on the Springfield Indians with this goal right here. The first shot taken by Yuri Poner was blocked in front. The rebound comes to Bob Bodak. He is very cool, calm, and collected on this one right here as he waits to the last possible moment. A turnaround nifty little backhander right beneath Ron Scott to give the Indians the early 1-0 lead.
Now in the center ice area, Housen. Rink wide for Markle. Dipsy doodles in right on a goal. Markle off the post. Oh, and he just missed. Markle and went around the defense and digged through, but then grazed it off the post. Now Dory on the far side pulls up, holds to make a play, and the Indians clear to center. And then in the neutral zone, Backman takes over. Leaves it for his own defense and cleared on the far boards, and now back after it. Big Peter Sawkins. He clears into the center ice area. And on the right wing boards, here comes Kontos. Centering in front, they score! Randy Heath on a beautiful setup. And with 16:52 left second period, right back. The Hawks tie it up at one.
Well, Randy Heath's been up and down between New Haven and New York this year, and he picks up a goal right here for the New Haven Nighthawks with 16:52 remaining in the second period. And you know the Springfield Indians have seen this happen to them on countless occasions this year. Get a goal and then have the opposing team come right back and get it. Heath gets the goal for New Haven, his 23rd, to tie things at one.
Now the faceoff at center now in this 1-1 game. The Hawks coming right back after the Indians had gained that 1-0 lead. And it's funny how things go. You play 22 minutes, no score, then two goals within less than a minute. Now the loose puck taken behind the net. Solheim is roughed up there, and then Kontos is able to clear one outside the line, and the Indians have to go back. It's funny also how close you can come to make it a 2-0 lead, as Markle had grazed one off the post, but instead the Hawks come right back and put one home here with 16 and a half minutes to go in the second period. The game deadlocked at one apiece. The scoring play, Heath is 23rd from Kontos and Backman at 3:08. The Indian scoring play, just one assist on the Bodak goal, Yuri Poner at the 2:26 mark.
Well, that's where we stand right now. Bodak gets the goal for Springfield, their first, and Heath comes right back to pick up their first. So We're right where we started from, 0-0 at the start of this period. We're still tied. It's 1-1 now.
Here are the Indians. Neal, lead cross-ice pass for Couric. Ends up going down all the way into the New Haven zone, and it's whistled down on an icing.
Don't forget, you can order your season tickets for the 1985-86 Springfield Indians season and take advantage of the Early Bird Special Season Ticket Package. This rate, of course, will be on the old ticket prices, this year's prices, for next year. Next year, ticket prices going up 50 cents to the new rates of $6 for the upper arena, $7 for the lower, and you can get this year's rate of $5.50 and $6.50 by ordering now before June 1st. You can call the Indians office at 736-4546 for information or send in for your season ticket brochure.
From the faceoff, Mike Neal has it behind his own net and covers up for the Tribe. Neal on the far side, checked off, and the loose puck taken by Don Biggs. Biggs, who played for Oshawa of the Ontario Hockey League. Stolen by Seguin, his shot blocked the defense and cleared all the way on a skittering shot into the Hawks end of the rink, and the New Haven club back to take over. Here's Stuart Smith clearing into the center ice area, and the Tribe's Jensen spins to get away from a checking Hawk player and then gives up the right side for Kerr. Rink wide for Solheim, but it's whistled down just offside at the Hawk blue line.
Well, that pass from Alan Kerr to Kenny Solheim, just a little bit behind Solheim. It got caught in his skates, and in his effort to kick it onto the stick, put himself offside in the process. 15:41 remaining here in the second period, tied up at one apiece. And don't forget, you can follow all the Indians action in the playoffs against the Binghamton Whalers right here on Continental Cable. We'll have all the home games for you as you take a look at some of the signs up here against the New Haven Nighthawk management. We've talked about that new internal problems they've been having, and there's some signs here put up by the New Haven boosters before the game, and that shows you the unsettledness in the New Haven operation.
Now on the left side, here comes New Haven. Stuart Smith across the line, leaving one through. It's centered right through the goal crease, and it deflects wide. Now on the near side, Hawk Seguin checked, and here's Henry. Lead pass for Archibald, then the clear, right in a goal. Shoots, Owen Scott gets a piece of it, and robs Archibald, who was sent in on the right side. Now Lawton on the far side, as the Indians' Archibald has lost his stick and the Hawks take over in the center ice area. Now it's cleared on the left wing side. Chance for New Haven as Patey pulls up, gives for Miner. Miner walks around Henry, walks right in on goal, but finally Leiter pokes it off his stick. Then Leiter skates in on the far side. They jam up and deflect one back behind the goal. New Haven doing the forechecking, bulk of it at this point. Finally Springfield trying to get it out of there. Now Lawton is bumped off the puck by Seguin. It's jammed in front. Hawks get to the right side. Quick chance by Gunsel, blocked to the defense. And here comes Springfield on a four-man rush to center. Pryor for Archibald. Archibald for Pryor, but it hops away in a two-man break for New Haven. Kennedy on the left wing side, closing in. Kennedy centers in front, but blocked off with the Indians defense, and a three-on-two break for Springfield. Johannesson with Archibald. To Johannesson, Archibald shoots, and Scott a piece of it. Good three-man passing combination. Here's Poner. Dipsy doodles. Backhands one, but blocked the defense and out to center. Come the Hawks, and finally Springfield recovers. We have 14 minutes left, second period. 1-1 as Johannesson slaps it off the boards into the Hawks, end of the rink. Bodak in the forecheck. He gets around one Nighthawk player, and then Poner to Bodak into the near corner. Bodak spun off the loose puck. Tries to center one. Poner back behind the net, also in there, and now Trache can't get his stick on it. Hawks try and clear out of there. Indians hold it in. Bodak at the side of the net. Here's big Bob, burly Bob Bodak on the far corner, spins to make a play as Springfield trying to do the controlling, but finally the Hawks come up with the puck and are able to wind one, but held in by Springfield's Johannesson. He clears back behind the net, and the Hawks take over, and Mike Gunsel is finally able to wind one all the way down after some good pressuring by the Indians. Vern Smith touches it, icing called against the Hawks.
Good pressure by Springfield. As you mentioned, Mike, the line of Yuri Poner, Bob Bodak, and Monty Trottier doing the bulk of the work in the Springfield, and rather in the New Haven zone. And Bodak, who was scratched from the lineup on Friday night, finds himself in the lineup here tonight on Saturday and does himself justice by picking up his 20th goal of the year for the only Springfield goal. As you take a look at some of the fans and of the smallish variety, enjoying that great concession food that you enjoy so much here at the Civic Center, and everybody does, and it's been a great year for everyone here at the Civic Center.
Now the Hawks clear to center, and Jensen fires cross-ice for Tripper, but blocked off the defense and then cleared to center where the Indians tripper shoots to the Hawks line. We're deadlocked at one as New Haven pick up the loose puck and feed one on the far side for Marty Dahlman. And Dahlman out of RPI, whose team, his former team, won the NCAA championship this year. Now on the far side, Brennan, checked off by Markle. Indians Jensen can't get it out of there. Back behind the net, Hawks try and center one. Lofthouse along the near boards, tied up by Neal. The loose puck taken by Dahlman. Now it's jammed up free on the near side, and finally Springfield can't get it out. Hawks hold that in. Here's Brennan. Skated off by Housen and Trimper, the loose puck for Springfield. Here's Trimper. A lead pass going all the way into the Hawks end of the rink, and New Haven have to go back. Now Markle intercepts a pass, deals it far corner, digs in, tries to make a play, holds on to that puck, centers for Housen. Housen to the left side for Neal, shooting, and the stop by Scott. Housen pinches in, goes back behind the net, tries to center one, wheels back into the far corner. Holds on to that puck. Backhander through, but blocked the defense and then cleared, but held in by Springfield's Jensen. Jensen for Housen, but blocked off there. Then at the side of the net, Trimper, the loose puck. Centered for Markle, the Neal. Backhander goes high, wide, but the Indians still control the loose puck. Here's Housen, centers in front, but Trimper couldn't get his stick on it. Neal holds it in for Trimper back behind the net. As the Indians, Housen controls, but finally it's blocked on the mesh behind the net and held by Scott.
Well, a lot of action in that sprint in the New Haven zone once again, with the Indians putting on some pressure on the Nighthawks. And Mike, you mentioned Marty Dahlman. He's been an unsung hero at the Springfield Civic Center for New Haven this year, getting a goal in overtime on one occasion to beat the Indians here, but climbed his way into the second position on the New Haven scoring list with 57 points. You mentioned his team, RPI, Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, winning the NCAA Division I National Championship this year, where he played last year and had himself 54 points in just 38 games, was a top scorer on that club last season. Marty Dahlman has had himself a good rookie year here in New Haven, as now we have a slight delay. They're repairing the glass here at the Springfield Civic Center. Two of the crew members down there, Bo and Scotty, working very diligently to get that finished up. And they are, as we mentioned, Mike, this ice crew in Springfield, one of the tops in the American Hockey League, headed up by Don Swindle, who is the leader of the entire crew. Larry, Carl, they all do an outstanding job. I don't want to leave anybody out because...
You've left out a couple, though.
Who'd I leave out on the ice crew?
It seems like you have.
If I did, they'll let us know next week.
I know they will.
Well, anyway, they've done a great job getting the ice in shape this year with some situations they were faced with basketball games, rock concerts, and they work at, you know, the wee hours of the morning to get the ice in gear after such events. They do an outstanding job, and in record time, the glass is back in place, so we just want to compliment them on their hard work this year because they've been great.
They soften the circle to the right of Scott, quickly shot on by Solheim, and the stop made by Scott. And we'll have another faceoff in the circle to the right of the New Haven goal.
Almost halfway through this hockey game, 11:35 remaining in the second period. We had no scoring in the first, but here in the second, a couple of goals, one for each team. Bob Bodak has scored for Springfield, and the New Haven goal scored by Randy Heath, and that's where we stand right now, tied at one.
Biggs now centering a line for Springfield as the loose puck taken by Kerr. Kerr loses the puck and skates, and the puck comes free and out the right side. Backman checked on the play. Loose in the neutral zone. Kerr can't get his stick on it, then cleared into the Springfield end of the rink. 11 minutes, 20 seconds. Left second period. We're deadlocked at one apiece as Pryor outlets on the right side. Hops over one player's stick, and then Kerr picks up the loose puck. Kerr tries to center for Solheim. Solheim is too closely checked, and the loose puck goes back behind the net where Heath recovers. Now Solheim for Springfield. Rice to center one, but New Haven can't get it out. Held in by Kerr. Set the side of the net for Solheim, but poked away, and Backman can't get it out. Indian Solheim for Kerr. Back for Biggs, right in. Shoots, and he also, I believe, went off the post. Now Pryor back behind the net, taken out of the play. Big jam up far corner. They still fight for it over there. Finally, it's locked free, and the Indians take control. On the far side, Indians Pryor back behind the net for Biggs. Biggs for the Indians. Centers one. Kerr can't get his stick on it. Loose again behind the net. Tried to whack it in front is Kerr, but then it's cleared on left wing, and Backman leaves it free. Quick pass in front for Contos, and the whole play whistled down offside up the Springfield line, despite the fact a few fans cheered because the puck went in the net.
Well, of course, we have a little bit of a rivalry going on in the stands here tonight. The Springfield Indians fans always rampant and riled and ready to go. We're going to take a look at that whole play that was whistled down offside, but also two busloads of New Haven fans made the trek up Interstate 91 for tonight's game. As you see that play that was whistled down by the linesman Dave Butova, they made the trek up, and we have a rivalry of words going on right beneath us downstairs between the two Booster Club members as you take a good look at Indians assistant trainer Ralph Calvinese and, of course, head coach Lauren Henning.
We don't want to get you involved in that. Keep you right up here with that little ankle problem you've been having, so we want to keep you up here and make sure you're all right. Now it's cleared into the near corner. Hawks try and get one in front. It's held in at the right point by the youngster Gunsel. His backhander is actually shot from the point step by Mullican, and we'll have a face-off.
Mike, you know Bob Bodak is red hot against the New Haven Nighthawks. This is his kind of club. He has 6 goals, 6 assists now for 12 points against the Nighthawks. He, along with Scotty Housen, who has also been hot against the Hawks. Housen, 4 goals, 6 assists for 10 points against New Haven. Two players on Springfield who like the pickings when the Nighthawks come to town.
Watt now will take the draw against the veteran Larry Patey. You'd mentioned Dolman scoring an overtime winner against the Tribe. Patey did as well in New Haven with just 12 seconds left on the clock. Here is playing the center ice area, and Howie Scruton off the boards into the center ice area, and the loose puck taken by New Haven as they clear into the neutral zone. Patey picks up steam across the line, pulls up, leaves it through for Gunsel. Gunsel centering one loose in front, and it's deflected wide. Hawks take control. Here's Patey shooting, and that's deflected wide. Scruton at the point. He winds it back behind the net, but Mullican trying to clear one for Johannesson. He able to get it for Henry, but stolen by the Hawks. Sawkins, whose shot goes wide. Now far corner. Hawks try and center one, but Lawton intercepts and outlets on the right side, and then it's cleared right back in. 9 minutes, 8 seconds, left second period. It's tied at one as New Haven intercept. Quick centering pass for Patey as the Hawks controlling play at this point. Here's a quick shot by Sawkins, but blocked the defense, and Mullican got a piece of it, and Archibald to center. He's tied up. A lot of play now on both ends of the rink as Johannesson feeds it off the boards into the Hawks end of the rink, and New Haven have to go back, and now the whole play whistled down on a two-line offside.
8:46 remaining here in the second period. To remind the fans of our trivia question here tonight, what current New York Islander was on the first ever regular season roster for the New Haven Nighthawks? As we're going to have a penalty assessed on the play, that's tonight's trivia. We'll be giving you the answer in the third period. New Haven's Al Tour gets a penalty here. And you've just written down another answer. And the answer that Mike has written down is Clark Gillies, and you're 0 for 2. The first one was Dennis Potvin. The next one was Clark Gillies. You're wrong on both counts, and three strikes, you're out. And, of course, you won't say it over the air. You're going to write it down, and if you're right, then you'll, of course, let everybody know you guessed it. But he won't go out on a limb here. The penalty, too many men on the ice to the New Haven Nighthawks. Originally, they put number 3 on the scoreboard, so I thought the penalty was on Al Tour. Tour will be the player serving the bench minor charge to the New Haven team for too many men on the ice, and the Indians go on the power play.
Well, the Indians, who have been stifled in the last 3 or 4 minutes, have a chance now. They're 0 for 1 so far tonight with the man advantage. Here's Housen, speeds through, drops it for Tripper. Here's the Indians captain pulling up, holding on between the circles, gives it for Leiter. Leiter, cross ice pass in front, Jensen scores! Dave Jensen on a beautiful passing play. And on the power play, the Indians strike and lead 2-1.
Over the course of the past 3 weeks, Dave Jensen has been outstanding for the Springfield Indians, especially when it comes to goal scoring. He gets another one right here. Beautiful pass from Kenny Leiter, cross ice to Jensen. He took his time, thought about it, got Scott to commit himself, and then picked out the top corner on a beautiful wrist shot by the former U.S. Olympian out of the University of Minnesota. There he is, Dave Jensen. He gets the goal on the power play for Springfield to give them the 2-1 lead.
Now in the center ice area, here's Bodak on the attack, but with the Hawk defense. Now Trache dropping it back for Neal, who sends it back for Jensen, who headmans it into the Hawk zone. Indians Bodak in after New Haven, able to clear one off the backboards for Dory. Here's Dory in his own zone. Clears all the way into the Springfield, then the rink reels on goal, and then Jensen has it for Springfield. Backhands it on the boards for Trache, but broken up at the Hawks line, and now it's fought for on the far side. Mad scramble, it's kicked at, and finally Poner can't get it out of there. Jensen for Springfield also. too well checked. And finally, Springfield's Trache able to clear the zone. It's 2-1 Springfield, that last scoring play. Jensen is 13th from Leiter and Tripper at 11:37 on a power play opportunity. And the Hawks take over in their own zone and clear to the Springfield line. But here comes Bodak on the attack. Moving in, shooting! Pat save by Scott. Now Trache, a backhander. He's knocked down. The puck ends up going wide of the net. New Haven taking control. Now Kennedy's too closely checked. And here's Poner on the pass from Bodak, but it deflects wide. Now Vern Smith, his shot deflects wide also, or ends up going wide of the goal, is Bodak for Springfield. He's pushed and shoved. Falls, but gives it to Pryor. Pryor pokes it to the far side for Alan Kerr. He spins to make a play. Now in his skates, he's unable to make the play, and finally the Hawks are able to lead one out the center. Here is New Haven into the Springfield zone. They try and work one free. Dahlman right in on goal, shoots. Milliken comes and makes a tremendous save. And then Verns covers up for Springfield. And we're going to have a penalty on the play, but Lauren Milliken, a stupendous stop.
Well, we talked about Marty Dahlman. He makes a beautiful move here, deking out defenseman Chris Pryor, who's going to get a high sticking penalty at the tail end of this play. Right around Pryor, Dahlman is, and watch the save by Lauren Milliken. As Dahlman took the puck to his backhand, Milliken stayed with him all the way. And then as the play circled out from behind the net, that man right there, winner of a couple of awards in a pregame ceremony here tonight, the player's player and the unsung hero, Chris Pryor, gets the penalty for high sticking. With 6:31 remaining here in the second period, we're going to see the high stick call right here. As you see Dahlman forechecking right here to thwart Smith from behind. There you see Pryor getting the stick up over the shoulder and getting in the way of Dahlman, and the penalty called by Noeth.
I hope you fans are enjoying the action as much as Jen and I are enjoying bringing it to you. 6:31 left second period. Pryor for high sticking, 13:29, and the Hawks have to go into the neutral zone. Here is Tour. Feeds it cross ice into the Springfield zone, and Milliken leaves it for Leiter. Now Leiter in his own zone. Checked on the play. Hawks try and center the loose puck. Here's Tour shooting one, and it deflects wide. Tour, fifth in the American Hockey League in penalty minutes. Now it's cleared back to the point. Tour shooting, and Milliken a piece of it, and clear but not out. Held in by Tour. He tries to center for Dahlman, but checked off by Springfield. Loose at the side of the goal, and then finally it's whistled on a high stick, going from one Nighthawk to another, and as a result, faceoff will come all the way back into the Hawks zone.
Well, that's the great part about this. That faceoff comes all the way down the other end of the ice. A minute 23 remaining on the penalty to Pryor. Let's see that play again as you see the shot taken from the point. Milliken kicks it out, then watch the high stick get in here right here as Al Kerr tries to get it out of the zone. The play will unfold a little bit. We let it run. You'll see it picked up right here. And, of course, when the play is batted down with a high stick in the opponent's end, like it is right there by Dahlman, the faceoff will come all the way down the other end. And that's what we have right here. And this will help the Indians out, definitely, in their cause to kill off this penalty.
Now it's cleared by Kontos in his own zone. Feeds it for his own defense with just a minute and 10 seconds left of the prior penalty. It's the Hawks on the attack, but blocked at the Springfield line and shot to center. Now on left wing, Backman clearing through, but here's Henry for Springfield. Closing in, Henry pulls up to make a play. Spinning, feeds it through for Biggs, closing in. Shoots, Scott to save, big rebound. Henry knocks it down, and he couldn't get a stick on it. Far corner, Henry for Springfield, the Biggs far corner. Here's Biggs with the Indians still shorthanded, but doing an excellent job killing it off, and out come the Hawks out of their own zone. Here's a lead pass for Dory. He's checked on the play, and then Biggs able to clear one into the center ice area for Archibald. His shot deflects wide of the net. Now Archibald to pinch in. Big jam up back behind the net with just 10 seconds left in Pryor's penalty. Out the other way come the Hawks. And the center ice area, Backman puts on the Jets into the Springfield zone. Holds up, centers one through. Kontos knocks it down. Pryor is back on. The Indians kill it off, and Pryor deflects one into the Hawks end of the rink. Solheim replaces him, and then the Hawks take over. 4:22, left second period. The Indians holding on to a slim 2-1 lead. As Seguin slapping one off the post. May have grazed the crossbar, and it ends up deflecting wide. Now to center, the loose puck taken by Springfield's Archibald, and leaves it for Vern Smith. We have 4 minutes and 5 seconds left in the second period. Indians 2-1 is the Indians. Solheim lurching in, feeds for Big, slapping one. Glove save Scott, and the loose puck taken by Scruton, who shovels ahead on left wing. Hawks into the Springfield zone, hold up at the blue line. Here's Miner, leaves it through, but hands it right to the Indians' Archibald, who backhands one for Biggs. Here's Biggs into the Hawks zone for a lighter, but the whole play whistled down offside, I believe. A two-line offside at the Springfield line to the New Haven side of center.
Well, with 3:40 remaining in the second period, there's your score, 2-1, the Springfield Indians on top. And Mike, I'd have to say here, strike three swinging and you're out on this trivia question. Folks, during that last flurry, Mike scurried himself to guess at the trivia question, which is what current New York Islander was on the original Nighthawk roster on opening night in their first ever regular season game. He guessed Rolly Melanson. He put it down in the paper here as he's been doing all night long so he could get some glory if he guessed it. And he's wrong on three counts. No Melanson, no Gillies, no Potvin, no more guesses. You're all done. You'll guess the whole team before the night's out.
Here are the Indians. Mullican clearing one away. Loose to the right side. Big jam up in front. Patey, a whack at it. Deflected high and wide. Miner taken out of the play by Johannesson. Seguin on the far side. Here's Steve Seguin. Muffed up in the loose puck taken by Springfield. Indians try and get it out of there. Hawks try and center one. Loose in front. Backhander. Mullican the stop on Seguin in front of the goal. And then Pryor covers up for Springfield and is able to clear one out the center and deep into the Hawks end of the rink. We have 2:58 left second period. It's 2-1 Springfield as New Haven clear into the Springfield zone. Here's a break for Miner. Miner for Seguin. Seguin wrist shot blocked the defense, and here's Bodak for Springfield. Bodak into the Hawks end of the rink. Tied up by Stuart Smith. Still trying to muscle his way to get that puck. It's for Trotche. Has Poner in front. Trotche in front for Poner, but blocked the defense. Trotche waited a little bit too long before passing that puck. And the Hawks take over in their own zone and clear to center ice. Now Jensen, left side for Markle, deflects into the Hawks end of the rink, and the loose puck skitters into the near corner. Markle and Stuart Smith fight for the loose puck. Indians pinch in, loose puck behind the net. Here's Housen, right in front, shoots! And the stop by Scott as he gloved it with Housen lurching in front of the goal.
Oh, what a great play here by Scotty Housen. He gets a great scoring chance on Scott, who comes up with a good save. Initial good forechecking by John Markle. Another indication of why he's been a spark plug of late for Springfield. Here you see Housen digging out the loose puck. Watch the shift he makes right here. And as he's thwarted from behind, it could have been a penalty right there on the New Haven defender. But there was no call. I believe that's Gunsel that upended him from behind. Scott made the save on the play, although New Haven very easily could have picked up the loose puck there and, of course, picked penalty in the process.
Now it's cleared back into the Hawks end of the rink, and New Haven take over and clear one up the left side with under 2 minutes remaining in the period. It's cleared all the way into the Springfield zone, and Neal takes over. Here is Neal in his own zone as we have some controversy up here, and it's cleared on the right side into the New Haven end of the rink. Unbelievable scene up here between the Hawks fans and the Indians fans, I believe. Roy Malacher and Peter Cooney having some words with the fans. As on the left side, New Haven pitching in. Jensen loses control. Here's Lofthaus, near corner. Lofthaus right in front, shoots Mullican, gets a piece of it, and then it's cleared outside the line and is center. What's happening up here, John?
Well, at the end zone, Peter Cooney really letting the New Haven Nighthawks boosters have it. And it started a feud between the fans, but let's stick to this hockey game.
I guess Roy Malacher's giving it to the Indians fans as well, so we have some words up here in the broadcast area with just under a minute to go in this second period. Here's Leiter closing in. Back behind the net. Markle also after it, but cleared away. And now what? The loose puck for Henry. Henry in front of the goal, but chopped away and outside the line. They're still jawing at each other, John. Now in the center ice area. The loose puck is taken by the Hawks with 30 seconds to go in the period. Up the middle on the right side, and New Haven take control. Here's Kennedy centering one, but deflected all the way down, and the loose puck taken by Scott and leads it for his own defense. 16 seconds left in the period as it's cleared to the center ice area for Leiter. Cross ice into the Hawks end of the rink. Big jam up over there. Indians Archibald then after it. Cleared with 5 seconds to go. Big jam up in the center ice area. 2 seconds left. Cleared and the stop by Malakin. And the buzzer sounds signaling the end of the second period. And the Springfield Indians score a couple of goals that lead 2-1.
Well, Dave Jensen's goal on the power play gives the Indians the lead at 2-1 after two periods. An outstanding period for the Springfield Indians. They got the first goal and took the early lead early in this period as Bob Bodak scored. Then New Haven came right back. Randy Heath gets the goal to tie it at 1. But then midway through that second period, it was David Jensen taking a beautiful pass from Ken Leiter on the power play and picking out a corner to give Springfield the 2-1 lead.
Well, the score here, it's 2-1 Springfield. We'll be back in just a moment.
The NCAA Women's Championships offer a highway to successful opportunities, challenging competition, excellent education, victories and medals, friendship and team spirit. This and more can be seen at any of the 34 NCAA Women's Championships. Get involved with college athletics. Attend an NCAA Championship this season. For dates and sites, write NCAA Championships, Box 1906, Mission, Kansas, 66201.
Welcome back, everyone. Mike Burek with John Forslund. After two periods of play, the Springfield Indians lead the New Haven Nighthawks by a score of 2-1 in a game that was scoreless after one, but both teams picking up the play in the second period.
Well, it started out early with Springfield Mike getting the first goal early on in that period, but New Haven closed the gap coming right back to score, which is something we've seen happen to the Springfield Indians this year. But then, very good goal on that power play. A power play that's been red hot of late for Springfield. David Jensen, a beautiful goal, and some great goaltending from Lauren Mulligan. So the try looks good through two.
Here's the first goal by the Indians, John, and it's by Bob Bodak.
Bob Bodak, very cool in front of the net here as he waited for Scott to commit himself and then wheeled a backhander, and he picks up his 20th goal, the sixth Indian to do so this year at 2:26 of that second period. Got things started for Springfield.
And a very big goal for the Indians in this scoreless game to make it 1-0. But wouldn't you know it, John, after John Markle had a chance as he grazed one off the post, almost made it 2-0, the Hawks came right back to tie the game.
Well, it didn't take long, and of course we don't have that goal, but Randy Heath came flying in right there and picked up a beautiful pass from Mike Backman. Kontos had set up Backman. Backman fed it right across the slot area. Heath knocked it in past Lauren Mulligan. He had no chance at it. Randy Heath's 23rd. That tied it at 1.
And you'll see the Indians take the lead at 2-1 on this goal coming right up. It was tied at 1, and here are the Indians taking the lead.
Watch Kenny Leiter draw the defender Twarm as New Haven was in their box formation trying to thwart off this power play. Leiter in deep in the New Haven zone laid a beautiful pass to David Jensen, who on the point in the power play has been red hot over the past 3 weeks. He had 3 goals in one game against New Haven earlier this year in a shootout down in New Haven, but he gets his 13th right here, 11:37 of the second period. David Jensen on the power play. That's where we are right now, 2-1 Springfield.
Well, the Indians are on their way, seemingly at this point, to a victory on our final broadcast this season on the regular season on Continental Cable. The score after two periods of play, the Springfield Indians lead the New Haven Nighthawks 2-1, and Bob Crocker will be your guest.
That's right, Bob Crocker, the Director of Hockey Administration for the Hartford Whalers, will be our guest. It's going to be interesting to talk with Bob, especially with the Indians taking on Binghamton, one of Hartford's farm teams, in the upcoming playoffs.
Hope you're enjoying the action, and we'll be back with more Springfield Indians hockey in just a moment.
Speed, excitement, emotion. It's wild, it's dramatic, and altogether electrifying. It's the hottest action around when the nation's best meet May 31st through June 9th in Omaha for the 1985 College World Series, an entertainment package you won't want to miss. The preceding message provided by the NCAA.